So as of last week, we're over 200 endings. That is not an exaggeration.
We gather together to honor the completion
of Vault 76.
I read on the internet that our games have had a few bugs. All new rendering, lighting, and landscape technology. It is four times the size of Fallout 4.
He is waiting for you. Will prove untrue. Then what will you do?
Bethesda purchased the rights to the Fallout franchise from Interplay in 2007. Their treatment of the series, its lore, setting, and overall atmosphere, and even their business practices and gameplay philosophy as a whole, extending over to the Elder Scrolls franchise, has led to Fallout getting buried under deeper and deeper piles of shit the more time passes by. New Vegas might be the only exception to this trend, but come on, everyone else is already talking about fucking New Vegas. I don't even need to say anything.
What's up, Reddit?
And it wasn't even developed by Bethesda. If we want to go back to when this series was young, fresh, teeming with optimism and brooding philosophies, with its virginity still intact, we have to go back to 1997. Hello, ladies and gentlemen. My name is Black Yoshi. Fallout is a turn-based, isometric view RPG, set 100 years after a nuclear war wiped civilization off the map. The details on how it occurred are foggy, but here's what we know. The Chinese thought they were hot shit.
So? Dare you compete with me?
Whatever!
Come on, man.
Xi Jinping may or may not have experienced ultimate gamer rage after failing to successfully invade Alaska during the Sino-American War. We know this because it's exposited to us in the first 5 seconds of the game, in a highly atmospheric and tone-setting cutscene narrated by Ron Perlman, the most deranged man in human history. The result? Everyone is living in mud huts, slinging crack on the streets, or becoming so irreversibly irradiated that they turn into Indians. You can almost smell the shit in the streets just from looking at the screen. Otherwise, these denizens of degeneracy spend their time mumbling incoherently to each other, getting assaulted by invasive Australian wildlife, or eating each other. In other words, California got what it deserved. Anyway, plot. You are some guy living in Vault 13, one of many nuclear bunkers built by Vault-Tec that are 100% foolproof and are in no way human guinea pig farms. The overseer tells you that the computer chip required to manufacture the MLG gamer fuel that the people of the Vault rely on to survive has gone kaput and that you need to go find a new one. You have 5 months to do so before the people of the Vault become so desperate that they start drinking from the tap. And boom, that's it. You create your character, are given a friendly slap on your shapely ass, and are thrown out into the wilderness. No waypoint, no quest marker, no direction or indication on where you're supposed to go. You're in the real world now, dickface. Good luck. The character creation, though simple, is incredibly advanced, and will easily weed out anyone reliant on ADHD medications attempting to play the game. Strength, perception, endurance, charisma, intelligence, agility, and luck are all your governing attributes, and actually have some pretty sizable effects on your character's performance in certain skills, unlike some other games. If that's too much for you to digest, you can always pick from one of three preset characters covering three primary playstyles. Max Stone, for example, learned from a very early age that he needs to use his head if he is to survive, that is, as a blunt weapon, repeatedly. It has not done wonders for his intellect.
Oh, you again. What want now? Huh?
Natalia is a woman who, like any female, is a sneak thief with a mean backhand. Albert is, to simply put it, a gigachad. Just look at that chiseled jawline. Pick him. Always pick Albert. While some of these skills might appear less useful than others, nothing should be underestimated. Throwing shit at your enemies might seem basic and barbaric. That is, until you learn about grenades. You might think you can genocide everything in your path without saying a word until you get thrown out of a church for merely sneezing in the priest's presence because your speech skill is so abhorrent. The combat! It's very good. It's turn-based, so it's a little basic, what with you having to take turns shooting at each other for 5 minutes, but when it's finally your time to shine, you'll find that... However, you will miss a lot, more often than not resulting in a perpetual standoff where victory is decided between who can run out of ammo faster. This is because, like any good RPG, the game runs off a dice roll system, just like real warfare. My advice? Go for the eyes. Or the dick. See, I don't fully understand the math behind it, but essentially aiming for the eyes in VATS deals more damage and has a far higher critical hit chance than in the head. Now, if people not being able to hit rats at point-blank range at the beginning of the game is anything to go by, then don't start using aimed shots until you have at least 100% in your weapon skills. As for aiming for the dick, enemies have a tendency to go down like a sack of potatoes after you give them what amounts to an involuntary vasectomy. However, you have no idea how many people I've seen write this game off because of its admittedly archaic combat system and unforgiving difficulty curve, to whom I would point and laugh at and tell to fuck off back to Fallout 4. I'll be over here making Doomguy look like a fucking janitor in comparison.
The gene pool is stagnant, and I am the Minister of Chlorine.
Yes, this game is difficult, but once you grind out a few hours on it and learn the ins and outs of the combat systems and learn to allocate your skill points well, you'll find that Fallout is a reasonably challenging, short, but rewarding experience. I think the game's short length works in its favor, too. After a short while, you'll know where everything is, what to do, how to do it, and how best to abuse the game's many systems to your advantage. Like gambling. Just hold down two keys and watch your wallet overflow with stonks as far as the eye can see. Best of all, each encounter in quest has enough leg room for you to decide whether or not you want to be a goody two-shoes, an asshole, or a self-serving mercenary. For example,
once again, unlike any of the other Fallout games,
you can find a thieves' guild hiding out in the hub.
Let's get the other bit of politeness taken care of, shall we? What the bloody, bloody, bloody hell are you doing here?
They only have one quest, but they give you an electronic lockpick as a reward, which helps you effortlessly unlock the door at the military base at the very end of the game. The quest itself is really easy to exploit, however. All I needed to do was waltz in with my power armor, enter combat, then exit combat as soon as I got out of the guard's sight, allowing me to blow myself up and the owner's strongbox to my heart's content. Yes, this game is really easy to abuse. And what better way to abuse this game's many systems than with a luck build? If you have a high enough luck, you can find this guy out in the middle of the desert selling used cars that haven't been used for at least 80 years. He's a little crazy, but not as crazy as this. The Red Rider BB gun, 25 damage, impeccable accuracy, high critical hit chance. It's so overpowered that you can easily kill the final boss with just 4 hits. Or how about the alien ray gun you can find in a UFO crash site that instantly vaporizes any motherfucker who so much dares is looking at you? Better yet, if you abuse the disgusting amount of cash you can get from gambling in Gizmo's casino, you can head straight to the Brotherhood bunker and get cybernetic implants that turn you into the fucking Terminator.
My vision is augmented.
Permanently upping all your special stats by 1 point. If you initially allocate your stats well and combine it with the power armor strength buff, you can easily force 5 of your 7 special stats to 10 out of 10, and then no one can fucking stop you. But I know what you might be thinking.
Why commit crimes against humanity on your own when you can do it with friends?
Excellent point, Mr. Strawman audience member.
Oh, thanks, man.
Yeah, that's enough. Go on, get out of here. Fuck off. There is a variety of companions scattered across the map of Fallout who are more than willing to join your merry band of war criminals. There is Katja, a follower of the Apocalypse with an expertise in the use of power fists. So she's probably a lesbian. There's some dog from Junktown who will only follow you if you approach him with a leather jacket. Ah, finally, a mutt with a grooving sense of style. Too bad all his teeth fell out from radiation poisoning because his attacks do little more than mildly annoy your opponent to death. Tycho? Is also from Junktown and sports a gas mask and trench coat. Somewhere. He's usually the one who dies first. There's not much else to say about him other than that. He's kinda useless. And last, but certainly not least, the defender of Shady Stands.
Shady Stands.
The defender of Shady Sands and all around dude bro, Ian. Ian was my first and probably best friend in the entire game. Oh, the fun times we had. Oh, how we laughed when he trapped me in the corner of a dark cave with his willy out. Oh, how we cried while double-teaming a prostitute that we had saved 5 seconds earlier. while the dog was watching. And oh, how I lost my shit after he kept shooting me in the back for the 50th goddamn time! What the fuck are you aiming at? And now for the music. It's so fucking good. This game would not be anywhere near the memorable experience that it is without its bleak, industrial, and despairingly imposing soundtrack. Right off the bat from you entering the first cave, you're greeted by the sounds of vault machinery, as well as a mysterious voice over the intercom. Echoes of the old world can be heard all throughout, especially the air raid sirens at the Lost Hills Brotherhood base. And every other piece of ambient music accentuates this feeling of uncompromising dread and hostility. You are not directly told, but it is heavily implied by the soundtrack alone, that anything could be lurking around the corner, awaiting you in this uncannily familiar but all too alien landscape. In my opinion, nothing else comes close to communicating the existential despair of a nuclear war than this game. Everything is either dead or dying. People loot, rape and pillage on the regular to make ends meet like it's popping to fucking Tesco's. All the while, something incomprehensibly dark lurks in the underbelly of this accursed land. Something that looks upon the land above and feels nothing but disgust, and seeks subjugation and assimilation above all else. Ladies and gentlemen, the master.
So what shall it be? Do you join the unity, or do you die here?
I don't have to prove anything!
Varied the...
Stop skipping my dial. Motherfuck!
He is the master, mind.
Get it.
Of a plot to convert all of the filthy, squabbling surface dwellers in New California into grotesque, green Shrek knockoffs. And, despite his ugly appearance and the absolute mind rape it takes to get to him, if you take time out to listen to his exposition, he actually kind of makes a little bit of sense.
As long as there are differences, we will
tear ourselves apart
fighting each other. We need one race.
Race!
One goal.
Goal!
Goal!
One people. To move forward to our destiny.
Destiny.
Fair enough. However, as everyone else would tell me, genocide bad, and his plan has one massive fatal flaw. His super mutants can't nut. And if you tell him this, he will straight up just kill himself out of pure shame. But despite all this, and especially if you're not particularly savvy to this very crucial fact, you can just join him anyway.
Aw yeah, boy, about to give me a big green bubble bath.
He is my favorite antagonist in the series, even over Mr. Hegelian dialectic degeneracy purger over here.
Mark my words, you piece of shit.
And I would be remiss not to mention that his voice actor is the same dude who voices Winnie the fucking Pooh.
So,
now you will join my army as a mutant, or you will die.
So, by now, I think we have a pretty roundabout way of summarizing the game. In spite of its short length, the game does a masterful job of feeling like an arduous spine-breaking journey between the difficulty curve and the small but noticeable character progression carrying you through each encounter. The narrative is basic but compelling, and is sold very well through the intricate writing, voice acting, and motivations for each character. This is a game made before the time where "War Never Changes" was contorted into a marketable slogan. Now, I would talk a bit about Fallout 2, but for all intents and purposes, it's just Fallout 1, but longer, with the same plot from before recycled with the circumstances and names in the script swapped around. And fuck, if that intro sequence isn't fucking boring. Yes, I am saying Fallout 2 is the Force Awakens of the Fallout series, and you will not make me take that back. Fuck you. That's Fallout. As usual, Patreon and Discord links in the description. Blah, 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 subscribe, blah, blah, blah. I'm not good at this whole YouTube thing, am I?
Master! Master!